Clerk, would you read the roll, please?
Yes, Ms. Cole.
Here.
Mr. Jones.
Here.
Mr. Schmidt. Mr. Lynn.
Here.
Mr. Morrissey. Mr. Welper.
Here.
Mr. Hart.
Here. Motion to approve the agenda.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. We are here today to talk about Noel's WIP program. I'm assuming that doesn't have anything to do with your kids, but...
I was going to wear a Devo hat. We can say, play WIP it.
Wow. Now that we've got that out of the way.
Button was rocking, just need to talk about it. The state of Iowa has now ended the enterprise zone program. As you may recall, this black line here was our enterprise zone area. The enterprise zone area was all determined specifically by census tract data. So it was based on vacancy of units, income in those areas, what's the definition of blight by the state code. The city of Waterloo, a number of years back, maximized the amount of area we could have in the enterprise zone. We wanted to be more flexible to try and draw more housing here. I would say in the last probably 3 to 4 years, we were having a great amount of developers interested in the enterprise zone. Specifically,
Noel, would it, I'm sorry to interrupt you, you're on a roll, but would it help to just explain what the enterprise zone is?
Sure. The enterprise zone is a state program, so essentially they gave a 10% investment tax credit on houses built in those areas. You had to build at least 4 houses, either 2 duplexes, 4 single-family, or 1 multifamily, which had to be 3 or more to qualify. It also gave them back a refund on their sales tax paid on construction purchases.
You know what? I just thought of something else. I'm sorry. If anybody's watching us on television, they can't hear you.
Are we on television?
Yes, we are.
Sorry.
I
put the board
and
there.
And these folks can't hear you either. I don't know. So if you could, if you can do it from there, my apologies for interrupting you now twice.
That's fine.
Where was I?
No, I'm going to do it. So essentially, developers could get about 15%. Give or take, with the 10% investment tax credit and the 5 cents on the dollar back, they could only go up to $140,000 per unit. So even if they were building $200,000 units or $300,000 units, it only went up to $140,000 per unit. So the enterprise zone, again, program was we believe, gaining in the ease of how it was set up. We had a local enterprise zone commission that had to review them. We would review them, recommend approval. We had some design criteria we had developed over the years, send them to the state. The state board would then approve them and send things back, and we'd get things built. Now the state has ended that program, but they have adopted a new program called the Workforce Housing Program in its place, the State Workforce Housing Program. It is essentially the same in terms of, it still gives a 10% investment tax credit. It still gives a reimbursement on the 5 cents on the dollar for the construction activities. The difference is there are no boundaries on the program. Now, with that being said, you do have to have an eligible site. So it could be anywhere in the city, but it has to be an eligible site. It has to be a brownfield or a grayfield site to be considered as an infill development site. So they're not actively giving the program incentives out for greenfield type development. Adrian can get into more details if you want to know. A city that could prove it didn't have any infill sites could apply for an exemption to go for greenfield development. They've already told us, don't think that as your first option, obviously, because a lot of communities have infill sites to go with, and we have a lot of infill sites we'd like to work on. The one other change in the state program with this new one is they are requiring a local match. We are pretty much covered for the local match. It requires a local match of $1,000 per unit. So we're covered because that can be by cash, it can be by abatement. We are covered in the CURA because the CURA, of course, and I don't know if Adrian, you want to show them that, that's the red line on the map. The CURA basically allows for either the 3-year or the 10-year tax abatement on residential, on commercial, or in industrial. So the CURA covers everything. So any new multifamily or single family units are covered in there under the WIP, under the workforce housing program, to be meet our match. We're covered for 1- and 2-family homes citywide because, again, we've adopted the CLRA. So as you may recall, the CLRA gives 3 years at 100% for anywhere outside of the CURA, but still inside the city limits. The one area we are lacking in having a match set up automatically with one of these two programs is if there's any multifamily sites that meet the criteria for the state program outside of the CURA. So we are working on, and there's one on the agenda tonight, of course. It was an enterprise zone program on Ravenwood, just east of the Ravenwood facility. He was kind of caught between a change and how they changed from the enterprise zone program to the workforce program. He's in the middle of his project, of his 72 units. I think he's built 20. He has 52 remaining. For him to be eligible to apply for the new program, we need to have some kind of a local match set up. I'm working with Michelle and my staff. We've been kind of brainstorming different ways to do this. The WIP program was written up by Chris Wendland to kind of meet these needs, basically saying that as long as a project site met the state criteria for this workforce housing program, that the city would, if approved by the council, obviously, have this policy in place to match that with $1,000 per unit. We had looked at going a couple of different options before we came to the one in front of you. We had looked at going with a small site-specific type urban revitalization or abatement program. So you just have some small little CURAs on there. We cannot do that unless we match the same incentives being offered in the CURA. We didn't want to give them 3 years at 100%. We just wanted to give them the $1,000 per unit, mainly because, as you recall, when we adopted the CLRA to begin with, staff's initial recommendation was to go ahead and give the CLRA tax abatement for all new residential. The GROW committee and the city council adopted it for one and two family only. So we didn't believe that the council wanted to come back and give 3 years at 100% for multifamily. So we've come up with this new program to give the $1,000 per unit. Essentially what we've set up is basically if it's not in the CURA, it's not in the CLRA, and it meets the workforce housing program criteria, that the city will give $1,000 per unit in cash when the project gets its certificate of occupancy at the end of the construction. Our funding source for this is we are planning on having this be a, I don't know if you want to call it a different classification. Previously we've had just straight demolition funds. We would like to classify the funds in that category as demolition slash housing funds. The reason we think that will work is otherwise we're trying to guess how many of these projects might come up. So in Paul's case there's 52, so we'd have to have 52,000 in there. Next year we could guess we need 50 and we might have a project come up and need 60 and we'd be short. The next year we may have none and we'd have some sitting in there not being spent, so we thought this gave us a little bit more flexibility in those bond funds. And we generally have those bond funds in place for demolition, asbestos, and all that on a year-to-year basis, so it's kind of a constant out there. So that's how we've set it up. I don't know if there's any questions.
Council?
No, just real quickly, you said that the pool of matching monies will come from your demolition fund?
Correct, and obviously, I can feel your concern from over here, Councilman Hart. Obviously, we're going to want to up the amount that we've been using in that amount, because we obviously still want to make sure we can meet our demolition needs on a timely basis as well.
Dave?
Noel, how does the Ravenwood area qualify for brownfield or grayfield?
It was an enterprise zone, so it qualified under the enterprise zone criteria. One of the grayfield criteria, and Adrian will correct me if I'm wrong, essentially is if the infrastructure has been in place for at least 25 years. In the case of him having had that as an enterprise zone, it would qualify under that since it was a previous enterprise zone, but it'll specifically qualify because a lot of that infrastructure was already in place before 25 years. If you recall that area, it's a U-shaped road now. It was kind of half built, and then all the water and sewer was put in there probably in the back in the 1960s or 70s. So we'll be looking at other sites. You know, another one that could come forward, honestly, that is out there is probably the high development project at Kimball and Ridgeway on the Covenant land, the one that did not get the state CDBG money. And we've been looking into that. It looks like that would meet the Grayfield criteria as well because the infrastructure that would serve that site is over 25 years. 25 years is the date the state picked for the Grayfield criteria.
And then what about the article I read in the Courier here recently about the development we've had the first half of the year? Wasn't the bulk of that multi-unit? I mean, aren't we doing a whole lot more multi-unit than we are single family and two home like the CLRA was designed for?
I'm not sure I remember the breakdown. We were ahead of last year's single family
I think 43-39. And then we were ahead of last year's multifamily 48-6 at that point that was reported in the paper. You know, and of course last year total we had 216 new units, so I'm not sure where exactly where we're at the end of this month. Craig's not going to make any movement back there because he probably hasn't done that report yet, but I mean, we're looking very good housing number wise. I don't know if we're different than we were last year at this time in terms of the percentage of multifamily to single family.
And I don't know that it's our responsibility versus letting the market, you know, bear what the market will bear, but it seems like we have got a boatload of apartments going up. And again, if our population is staying somewhat stagnant, I don't know where that leads us that would be a good thing.
I mean, obviously we hope the population is going up. I think one of the most recent American whatever survey, forget what it's called, documents came out, had us up, I think, by about 600 people. I don't know how accurate those are from time to time because they fluctuate. We've spoken with a number of the multifamily developers. They kind of had the same question. I kind of think it's funny when they ask me, do you think we're building too many? That's kind of their job, not mine. Right. We're just here to help them do it. All I know is they keep building them, they keep filling them up.
All right, thank you.
Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir, Mr. Mayor.
Noel, does this obligate the builder to any kind of, you know, moderate income?
It does not. I'm glad you brought that up. There's no income limitations on who can live in these, but again, they're limited in what they can get back. So even if it cost them $200,000 per unit to build them, now they can get $150,000 of that credited back to the 10% in the 5 cents in the dollar. But no, they can. There's no income limitations for residents.
And you don't think we're gonna?
And they do have a three-year time frame to build them, 3 year. So when they're approved, they have 3 years to get it built.
And you don't think like high development, that's gonna go anyway, isn't it?
That I do not know. Are obviously there? He has a $3 million gap from his initial financing setup. You know, in terms of what we're thinking is, this is a new program put statewide. If it's an eligible site, we want to be able to compete with other sites statewide that are looking at this money. You know, high development's a good example of here's a developer from out of town looking to develop here. If we didn't have a program that would make him eligible for the workforce housing program here, but he could get it in Marion, then he may go build there instead. And obviously we want to get new residential and new people here as well.
But they still get the enterprise zone deals. It's just that now we're adding another $1,000 to that.
They would not be. They cannot get the state incentive without our match. It's required.
That's what I mean. But if we do it,
yes,
they'll get what they.
They'll get the 10% investment tax credit and the refund on sales tax.
And another.
Yep.
Anybody else? What's your timeline, Noel? What are you going to ask of council, and when does this program start? If it passes.
I think we had it starting upon approval, if it's voted in place tonight, because
there's nothing on tonight, I don't think.
Is
it?
There's a resolution.
And then there's actually a agreement on there with Mr. Moore. Mr. Moore's situation, you know, he basically built the second part of that road.
Oh.
He's built some of the units. He's basically spent a lot of money up front with the idea of finishing this project and having the revenue come in at the end, and he's kind of stuck between a rock and a hard place if he can't build the rest of the units because he can't get these tax credits. He's in deep trouble.
Yes, sir.
Noel, can you tell us a little bit about the economic benefits as a city to this additional outlay of $1,000 a unit? There is an upside to the city. Can you talk about that?
Obviously, anything we can do to promote housing here is an upside. You know, housing brings new residents, brings new employees for our employers to draw upon for workforce. Brings people shopping, which is going to bring retail development. Brings people buying gas, local option money, and all that. The $1,000, I forget, we calculated up a couple of townhomes how much they'd be paying, and it's basically 1 year. They'd be getting like 1 year of taxes free at $1,000 per unit.
So it's pretty fast payback for our $1,000 investment.
Correct. Yes.
Say that again, the $1,000 equates to about?
Yeah, if he goes out there and builds a six-unit townhome, and he gets $1,000 per unit back from us, we're getting the taxes back pretty quickly. That's equivalent to almost 1 year of tax abatement, probably even less.
Gotcha.
Further? Thanks, Noel.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? We're adjourned. Thank you.
Building and Grounds Committee to order. Will the clerk please read the roll?
Mr. Jones?
Here.
Mr. Schmidt?
Here.
Mr. Morrissey?
Motion to approve the agenda as proposed.
Second. We have a motion and second for the agenda. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. We have an agenda.
Mr. Chairman, if I could take those items of new business.
Please, Mr. Schmidt.
First, we have authorization to construct a 10 by 12 foot building for the City of Waterloo fueling site. Second, we have authorization to approve a request by Jeff Walters to purchase a 30-foot by 32-foot metal pole building located at 4012 Leversey Road for $500 with a development agreement. And finally, we are asking for authorization to approve a request by Properties LC to purchase a vacant lot located at 520 Locust Street for $500 with a development agreement. I move we approve those three items.
Second. So we have a motion second on those. Is there any discussion?
Do we want to have Chris, you want to talk to us a little bit about two and three?
All right, we'll do the request to purchase the metal pole building. I'm sure you guys remember that's property we bought from the Welters years ago. It's a pretty new building, which was built in 2008. I just hated to tear it down when I was getting a lot of calls for it. And Mr. Walters, of all the calls that I received, seemed to be the only one absolutely prepared to do the project. So that's why we're here today for that one. 520 Locust, I just want to make a clarification. It was originally understood that that lot was going to be for parking. However, the applicant owns the rental house next door and would like to have simply green space for the children that live in the rental house for a place to play. The lot that his house is on is extremely small. It's about the same size as this one. So it will be green space and not parking. And both applicants are here if you have questions for them.
Chris, can I ask on item number two, I mean, did we do some kind of a bid process? Or, I mean, are we going to be having anybody come to us saying, gee, I didn't get an opportunity to bid on that, or is this a conversation that's been going on for a while?
We did not do a formal bid process on that. During the demo bid process, I was getting a lot of calls, so I made that, the demolition of that particular building, a secondary item that could be added at any point if I didn't get the building sold. Like I said, it's awful new. I just hated to have it just go straight to a landfill. This is just first come, first serve. There could always be someone, once they see it in the paper, come forth and put in a bid.
Thank you.
Chris, on number three, so there is no development agreement on number three, since it's just open space, green space?
I personally didn't know what development agreement you would write for a green space, but it's up to you guys if you want to require something else, but I didn't see any reason to require a development agreement.
So hating to speak on behalf of another councilman, but I think there was some concern about this being turned into parking. So we don't need a development agreement for that, because for them to park here, if it weren't paved, if it were not part of some kind of development agreement or didn't meet the other code issues, we'd be able to enforce no parking there, correct?
Correct. They would have to pull a permit to put the parking in.
We do have a development agreement on the agenda. As part of the agenda item, it says with a development agreement.
Yeah, that's with, originally it was thought that that was going to be the parking, but being that it's going to be green space, I don't see why you'd have a development agreement for green space.
So then we might want to amend the motion to delete the development.
Well, also, does it conform then with the property sale rules then, if there is no development agreement? No?
That's what would that allow, is it a couple thousand bucks?
You might want to have one for maintenance of the property, or just kind of like mowing.
Well, isn't that in there already? I mean, you have to, we have rules about mowing and such. Right, so it should fall under that.
If that doesn't allow you to take the property back, it's not going to take care of it. You go under the code and you just cite them. In a development agreement, you would probably have to retain ownership.
Do we want to retain ownership, though? These are excess properties, right, that we were trying to dispose of, and if we could put it to good use, but it doesn't conform. And Ron's looking at me, scratching his face there.
Can I ask a question? What size, Chris, what size is that lot?
27 feet wide by 70 feet deep.
So it's not buildable.
So, and how much does it cost? Three times as much maybe as the assessed value to be able to maintain that lot per year?
I would say yes. It would be, if we mow each lot probably in excess of 10 times a year at about $27 a pop.
And you also, is there a need to do anything in regards to snow for sidewalks or anything around that?
Yes, it does have sidewalk in front of it, so we would have to do snow removal as well. The cess, which I don't agree with it, it's $3,530.
Really?
Three times.
That's old cess value.
Could it really be assessed that high? I mean, it's a non.
$3,530.
It's what?
Without a structure on it.
Yes, it's vacant land. We demoed the. This is a 657A property. We demoed it in 2010.
Hmm. And it's not buildable. Ron, you going to weigh in on this?
It's not my committee.
So you have no thoughts?
We've had this conversation about we have these variety of lots that are virtually worthless, and all the arrows drag on the city. So I can sleep with that.
And right now it's not on the tax rolls, right?
Has not been since we got it in 99. It got demolished in 2010.
So once the person pays for this, it goes back on the tax rolls.
Goes back on the tax rolls. We know, more importantly, we don't spend the several hundred dollars mowing or snow removal.
I would, if you, I forgot who made the motion to strike the word development agreement out of your motion, if you would amend that.
Is that what we decided we needed to do?
If we're not going to do a development agreement, then yes, we need to amend your motion to.
Okay. All right, Mr. Chairman, that a motion to strike.
Mr. Chairman, may I ask what the taxes will be? What the city will be receiving in taxes on this property for this half lot?
Yes.
How much? How long is it going to take for the city to get their money back?
Oh, a lot this zero. Size, without actually crunching numbers, just based, and Michelle looks like she's...
Quite a few years.
When you're paying more and snowing,
which you have, sure.
It's $1,000 a year, plus the $500.
I'd say taxes alone, if I take it 10 years.
Well, we
with mowing the smaller ones. We'll take it.
Yeah.
Maybe two.
Well, yeah. I mean, even if you, so the taxes are maybe $62 a year, the city share. And even if it's $300 a year for mowing, that's a long time to.
We usually try to get our money back within 8 years.
In the,
is that correct?
In the Cura.
Mm-hmm. How much a
month? What's that?
How much a month?
$27 a time.
$27 a time.
$70 a year.
Right.
Plus snow. Plus the $500 that we'll be receiving. Plus the $62. So that's $500 almost a year just in snowing and mowing. I mean, snow and mowing. Yeah, I was right the first time. Never correct yourself. But so that's $500 a year.
Right. And one thing I think we overlook a lot is liability. If someone hurts themselves on a lot, we have to address it.
So I would amend that motion to take out the development agreement.
Okay, so we have a motion, and I'll second that. So we have a motion and proper second for the three items, the third taking out the development agreement. Is there any additional discussion? Seeing none, those in favor?
Aye.
Vote aye. Aye. Opposed, same sign. That item passes.
Motion adjourned.
Second. Those in favor, vote aye. Aye. We're adjourned.
Let's call a Human Resources Committee to order. Madam Clerk, would you read the roll, please?
Yes, Mr. Welper.
Here.
Mr. Hart.
Here.
Ms. Cole.
Here.
Mr. Jones.
Here.
Mr. Schmidt.
Here.
Mr. Lynn.
Here.
Mr. Morsi.
Motion approved. The agenda is proposed.
Second.
We have a motion and a second on the approval of the agenda. Is there any questions or discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All the same sign, that motion carries. I think we can take both of these together today if someone would like to take them both.
Move to approve a request from the building official to initiate civil service process to fill a position of permit writer and make an appointment, and also a request from the public works director to initiate the civil service process to fill a position of sanitation operations supervisor and make appointment.
Second.
A motion a second on both requests. Would you like Craig or Mark to address either one of those questions, those requests, I mean?
Mr. Chairman, the first one is a replacement. Are they both replacement?
The first one is for sure.
The second one is due to a vacancy, but we are changing the position from a foreman to a supervisor.
Because?
A foreman isn't allowed to. Yeah, Mark can explain.
Mark Bryce, Public Works Director. What I'm doing is proposing that we change this to a non-bargaining position. And my reasoning behind that is the position needs the ability to supervise. It needs the ability to appraise employees, which a bargaining member can't, as well as be able to make decisions with citizens on behalf of the city, and also to be able to make decisions for me in case of my absence, which I don't have anybody right now.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Hearing none, Madam Clerk, can you roll call, please?
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes.
Motion to adjourn.
Very good. Those two motions passed. Thank you.
Second.
Motion for adjournment. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All in favor? We're adjourned. Thank you.
Finance Committee meeting to order, please.
Madam Clerk, please take the roll.
Ms. Cole?
Here.
Mr. Schmidt?
Here.
Mr. Jones?
Here.
Motion to approve the agenda as proposed and the minutes of the March 9th meeting.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Discussion? Seeing none, all in favor, vote by the sign of aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
Madam Chairperson, I'd be delighted to take those travel requests. First, we have from the PD, Sergeant Rasmussen and Sergeant Duncan, and that's to attend the homicide investigation meeting in Richmond, Kentucky from March 29th through March 31st at amount not to exceed $836. Next, we have Luke Even from the, or he's a forestry foreman, and Justin Lampert, a park maintenance two with Forestry Department to the 53rd Annual Minnesota Shade Tree Short Course in Arden Hills, Minnesota, March 17th and the 18th, at amount not to exceed $429. And finally, we have Philip Schubert, stormwater specialist, to attend the International Erosion Control Association Spring Conference in Lincoln, Nebraska, March 23rd and 24th, at amount not to exceed $355. I move we approve those three items.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Have we discussion?
I have a question. Item number one, Dan, Joe, are those gentlemen going for, I assume they're gentlemen, going for certification or training, or is that any requirement for the department?
Captain Joe Lyle with Waterloo Police. That is actually traveling to investigate one of our unsolved homicides.
Oh, that's not for training.
I'm sorry. Not training.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Okay. All in favor, vote with the sign of aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Those items pass. We have some pre-offs.
Madam Chairperson?
Yes, sir.
We've got building and maintenance in the amount of $6,039 to install a pair of doors, provide new door closures to employee area at Five Southern Brothers Convention Center. Building maintenance, $13,135 for a 10x12 shed at Waterloo Fueling Station site. Building maintenance, $5,049.50 plus $250 shipping and handling for five black mega coat racks with hangers, six foot portable folding with casters. Oh, for five Sullivan Brothers Convention Center. Clerk's office, $2,450 for a Canon DR610C scanner document management system. Human rights, $20,000 for advertising expenses. Leisure services, $1,267.80 for Class 3 safety rain gear and Class 3 safety vests. Leisure services, $105 for portable handicap accessible restrooms placed in various parks. And leisure services, $11,238 for trees purchased for the Plant Some Shade project. This is a project with the Iowa DNR and Mid-America Energy. Leisure services, $2,200 for annual flowers to be planted in 24 of the saucer-style planters at River Loop Expo Plaza. Leisure services, $2,300 for hazard lighting on two new city vehicles. Planning department, $9,625. To move existing light pole next to Muru sign to opposite side of sign and move Ridgeway Place pylon sign. Planning, $7,258 for demo of 506 Reed Street. Police department, $3,200 plus $50 shipping and handling to repair pole camera and replace new IP camera. Police department, $3,099.61 to purchase community affairs items such as pens, t-shirts, bags, water bottles to be given out at various domestic violence workshops. And street department, $1,278 plus $75 shipping and handling for traffic sign materials.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Discussion?
I just had a quick question on human rights, and I know Abraham, I don't see him here, so I don't know if Michelle, if you're able to answer, I guess. My question is that $20,000 on advertising, is that typical? And I'm also wondering whether or not there might be a better utilization of that money. And I don't know if that's a fair question for you or
Those funds are from their special partnership grant, so those were designed to be used for advertising, so it's not really typical of them, but they have special funding for that.
And that's what it's supposed to be used for?
Yes.
Thank you.
Anything else?
Sorry, just a real quick question for Paul on the $105 per unit for portable handicap accessible. Are those portable toilets?
Yes, the 105 is per, and they're at a number of sites. Yeah, they're okay. They're porta potties.
Gotcha.
Commonly known as porta potties.
Thank you.
All in favor, vote by the sign of aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Those items passed. I move that we approve a budget line item amendment, copy on file in Ms. Scher's office, and also that we pay the bills, which are $1,858,841.63, 1,858,841.63.
Second.
Motion, second, discussion? Seeing none, all in favor, vote by the sign of aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Those items passed. Bless you.
Thank you.
Motion adjourned.
Second.
Yeah. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? We are adjourned. Thank you for your time.
Thanks.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this regularly scheduled meeting of the Waterloo City Council this Monday, March 16th. Madam Clerk, would you read the roll, please?
Yes, Ms. Cole.
Here.
Mr. Jones. Mr. Schmidt.
Here.
Mr. Lind.
Here.
Mr. Morrissey. Mr. Wilper.
Here.
Mr. Hart.
Here.
Very good. Thank you, ma'am. If you would all join me, please, in standing for just a moment of silent reflection and prayer, please. Thank you very much. Our pledge tonight is going to be led by Mr. Larry Smith, our Superintendent of Waste Management Services. Larry, please.
Please join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. May we see
you. Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Hart.
Move that we approve the agenda as proposed, and also with the approval of the agenda, I move that we approve the minutes from March 9th regular session and March 5th special session as proposed.
Second.
Council, do you have any comments or questions regarding the agenda or the minutes? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. That motion carries.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Hart.
I move that we receive, file, approve the consent agenda items 1A through B3. Also, with the approval of the consent agenda, I move that we approve our bills payment, which will be read by our finance chair.
The bills this week are $1,858,841.63, 1,858,841.63.
Second.
Council, do you have any questions or comments regarding the consent agenda? It's a roll call vote, Madam Clerk.
Ms. Cole.
Yes.
Mr. Jones.
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt.
Yes.
Mr. Lind.
Yes, except 1B, 1A, C, and D.
B, 1A, C. Mr. Wilper.
Yes.
Mr. Hart.
Yes.
Motion's carried. Thank you, Council. Item number two, please, our first public hearing.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Schmidt.
Item number two is a motion to receive and file proof of publication of notice of public hearing, and that's for the parking management services.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. That motion carries, and that hearing is now open. Madam Clerk, do you have any written objections on file to the parking management services RFP?
We do not.
Is there anyone in the audience that would like to speak either for or against this item? Mr. Walsh.
Hi, Jim Walsh. I guess I can tell you now I live in Cedar Falls, but I have a whole bunch of businesses in downtown Waterloo, and I'm here to support your adopting a professional management company to handle our parking needs. As you know, and those who've worked on it well know, many of the larger cities in Iowa have gone to this with the understanding that it's too difficult a job for municipal employees with other responsibilities to handle on a day-to-day basis. I would suggest that you seriously consider the next step, though, at the same time, which is separating the finances of the parking operation from city finances by creating an entity something like our Waterworks, a separate entity that is publicly owned, that does report through this council, that does have audited books, that nobody separately owns. It's owned and controlled by the city, but operated separately. Separate all finances out, let them run the operation. They don't take the profits home. The profits stay here, if there are any, but they make sure that all money in parking is directed back towards parking to improve it and make it available to people who use our downtown, and hopefully more and more of those will be coming downtown. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Walsh. Is there anyone else in the audience that would like to speak either for or against the parking management RFPs? Second time?
Mr. Mayor, I make a motion to close the hearing and receive and file oral comments.
Second.
Council, do you have questions, comments, concerns at this point?
Mr. Mayor, I would just echo Mr. Walsh's comments. I'm not everything he said, but having been the liaison to the Main Street Board for a number of years, I know this downtown parking issue has been a constant item of discussion that, and I think, as Mr. Walsh said, I think it maybe is a little bit more than what we're prepared to manage. I do know from spending quite a bit of time in Dubuque and Cedar Rapids that theirs seem to run a little bit differently. I know the rates are higher, so I think that's probably going to be part of the overall picture, but I also think you get what you pay for, and we've just got some problems with this, so I think it's going to be a good thing.
Mr. Mayor, and to also to echo off those comments, taking a look at the usage of parking in other cities, major cities as well, I was looking at one of the RFPs, and there was actually a marketing plan to promote more parking downtown, so I just want to make sure we continue to take a look at getting as much use as we possibly can from whichever company that we support.
Very good. Further comments? Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we adopt a resolution confirming approval of specifications, bid document, etc.
Second.
We didn't vote on
the closing
hearing. So all in favor, please say aye. Opposed, same sign. Motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, now I'd like to adopt a resolution confirming approval of specifications, bid document, etc.
Second.
Madam Clerk.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lind?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to adopt a resolution authorizing to proceed.
Second.
Madam Clerk, please.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lind?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Very good. The motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, I'd like to make a motion to receive and file and instruct the city clerk to read bids and review.
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Very good. That motion carries. And ladies and gentlemen, we have two bids. We're not going to read them tonight. We just got them, and they are two bound packages that has a plethora of information. There's a group, Craig Clark and Susie among them, and others that will go through these bids and try to ferret out costs and services provided, and et cetera. One is from Republic Parking Systems. One is from ABN Parking Response. So we will get back with you as to what these two Hold. Let's do resolutions, please. 3, 4, 5.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Hart.
Move that we adopt a resolution improving methamphetamine drug hotspots grant money as subrecipient from the Governor's Office of Drug Control Policy in the amount of $18,892, with no matching funds required, to provide overtime funds to assist in mid and high level methamphetamine investigations, and authorize mayor to execute said document. 4, I move to adopt a resolution approving award of contract to Aspro Inc. of Waterloo, Iowa, in the amount of $3,494,504.20, and approving the contract bonds and certificate of insurance for the FY 2015 street reconstruction program, base bid plus alternate A plus Division 2, contract number 873, and authorize mayor and city clerk to execute said documents. And at 5, I move to adopt a resolution approving construction plans for paving, sanitary sewer, and storm sewer serving Audubon Heights 5th Edition, as submitted by Wayne Clausen Engineering and Surveying, Inc. of Waterloo, Iowa, and the Sewage Treatment Agreement, DNR, Form 29, November 2000, with the Department of Natural Resources, and the final acceptance of construction plan subject to review and acceptance by the DNR, and authorize mayor to execute said document.
Second. Very good. Council, do you have any questions regarding any of those three? Madam Clerk, please, it's a roll call.
Mr. Lind?
Yes.
Mr. Wilper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Very good. Thank you. We can do the last, is that the last three? Last three, yes. Let's go, is there three or four?
Three.
Let's do the last three. Ms. Cole, please.
I move we adopt a resolution approving award of contract to Grooming Rock Products of Decorah, Iowa, in the amount of $259.9 per ton with $5,000 mobilization, and approve the contract bonds and certificate of insurance for the FY 2015 salvage asphalt crushing project, and authorize mayor to execute said documents. 7 is a resolution adopting the Workforce Housing Investment Program. And 8 is a resolution supporting the application by Hammond Hills Development LLC for the Iowa Workforce Housing Tax Incentives Program, and approving a Workforce Housing Investment Program funding agreement to construct 52 new housing units located in the Hammond Hills 6th Edition.
Second.
Awesome. Questions?
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Hart.
Good question. In regards to number 7, since this is a slight change from what we've been doing before, how are we going to communicate with potential developers and people as such to make sure they know about this great opportunity they have?
Eric Schrader, city planner. We work closely with the developers on all of the different incentive programs that we have. We have some maps and literature on that. We will update that literature. I think we would also look to maybe try and get some updates on the city's economic development website, and we're open to any other additional suggestions on how we can get that word out there.
Okay, so comments, just send them to you and you'll...
Okay. Absolutely.
Thanks, Eric. Eric, isn't there a degree also that developers become aware of this stuff pretty quick and they know about it?
I think so. And I mean, in the main program that this is designed to support is a state program, and you know, most developers are pretty aware of what's going on at that level if they're truly trying to compete.
But we certainly want to do all we can to get that message out. Mr. Yes. Schmidt?
I was just going to ask Eric, is there a timeliness to this? And I guess the reason I'm asking that is I don't know how long this program has been in effect or been available. But I mean, we just heard about it tonight. Now we're voting on it tonight. It's not a three-vote deal. So it's moving rather quickly, and I'm just wondering.
Yeah, it hasn't been in effect or available at all yet. This upon adoption tonight, it would be the first time it is in effect and available. Regarding the timeliness, that is really more key to the number 8 on the agenda, which would be the first request approved under the program. And under that particular item, that's a particular project that does have some timeliness issues. It's in a situation where the development of those 52 housing units around the Ravenwood Circle area was approved under the old Enterprise Zone program. They kind of got caught in the middle where the Enterprise Zone program ended and the new state workforce housing program initiated. The programs are very similar. Both will allow the tax credits to be transferred. The old program allowed that as well, but they ended that, and now the applicant, the developer is in the audience. He can speak a little more on the timeliness, but he's in a situation where under the old program, he would not be able to transfer credits. It makes the project unfeasible to move forward with him. Under, he can qualify under the new program, but the new program requires $1,000 per unit local match, which can come from different sources. Tax abatement could be one, but we don't have a real easy mechanism to do a tax abatement on this site since it's not in the CURA. It is in the CLURA, but the CLURA does not provide tax abatement for multifamily, which this construction is. So, Paul, do you want to add to that?
Hi, my name is Paul Moore with Hammond Hills Development, and I am the developer and the contractor on the project that Eric spoke of. The new program, workforce housing tax credit, is a much needed item to fulfill that development in that part of town. It's the most recent development in and around that piece of land is 30 to 35 years old. So there are some challenges with incenting people to come into new construction through the older construction, heavily rental base. So that is the gist of why we're pursuing this. The tax to the city as it's completed will be in the upwards of $2,000 to $2,600 per unit built yearly. So relative to a payback, it's there from the city's point of view.
And Eric, I'm sorry, when I was asking about if this is new, I didn't mean locally, because I know we're just passing it tonight, but I mean, is this a state program? So is this a new state program, or is this an interim program?
It is a new state program that replaces the old state program that was the Enterprise Zone. I mean, and the state program is out in effect right now, but it requires that local match. So we have a mechanism inside the CURA to where pretty much anything, single family home, duplex, multifamily, it doesn't need this local policy that we're asking you to adopt under number 7, because it gets tax abatement and that can qualify as the local match. So we're just proposing this new program under number 7 to cover outside of the CURA for multifamily, because that outside of the CURA, you would be inside the CLURA, and if you're building a single family home or a duplex, you'll qualify for the tax abatement. You won't need this program. So it's only outside the CURA multifamily that qualifies for the state's program, because that's the other way this thing is written, is you have to qualify for that, which it ties it for the most part to like brownfield, grayfield sites. So a greenfield, new construction, new roads, new infrastructure out, you know, on a farm field is not going to qualify under the state program, and therefore would not be able to qualify for the $1,000 per unit proposed under this program.
And the reason for my questions is not that I'm necessarily opposed to this, I'm just asking from a timeliness standpoint, because did you just say that we don't know for sure where we're going to come up with the $52,000? We haven't identified that yet.
The program proposes that it be essentially paid back at a certain time period after they've received final occupancy of the units and certification that they've received the state housing, workforce housing incentives. So it is not like anything that the council would approve an agreement on, you know, one particular day, it's going to be quite a ways down the road before we would actually be issuing a check to that. The proposed funding source is out of capital improvement bond funds. Specifically, Noel is requesting to increase the amount that's put under the nuisance abatement, which primarily is used for demolition. It wouldn't have to go there, but the reason he's proposing it there is it provides some flexibility. If it was a standalone line item in the capital improvements program, it's going to be hard to really guess how many units. You know, we've got 52 here, which is $52,000. What other projects are going to step up? So then it can be, you know, a little bit less of a guessing game if it's kind of pooled with the demolition funding as well.
Thank you.
I will just add, Mr. Schmidt, too, I'm not sure if what your pleasure is on this, but we don't have a meeting next week.
Right.
So this is going to be delayed for at least 2 weeks. Yeah. And Mr. Moore is anxiously awaiting an answer on this. So just maybe all of you could take that into consideration as you ponder this. Are there further comments?
Mr. Mayor, I know I'm not supposed to.
Mr. Walsh,
Enterprise zone funding is something we've used in the city for years.
Okay, I'm sorry to hate to ask you, but please tell us who you are.
Oh, I'm still Jim Walsh. Enterprise zone funding is not new. This is a new extension of that funding for the city of Waterloo. We haven't before taken money from city and given it to people who weren't in an enterprise zone area under the state program. I'm not saying I'm against it, that's fine. But as the state has done in many instances, they're revising these programs and making them more generally applicable and applying beauty contest standards to them that didn't used to exist. We used to just send an application in, and if you're building in an enterprise zone, you'd get the credit. Now you have to qualify, and they make you jump through a bunch of hoops, but it will cost some more money if housing isn't built where it used to be built.
Thank you, Mr. Walsh. Council, do you have further questions? Madam Clerk, it's a roll call vote on 6, 7, and 8, please.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes on 6, no on 7 and 8.
Very good. The motion carries. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, item number 9, please.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Hart?
Move to receive, file, consider, and pass for the first time an ordinance amending the 2008 traffic code by amending section 551, parking prohibited at all times on certain streets, by deleting section 208 Kimball Avenue and inserting in lieu thereof a new 208 Kimball Avenue, both sides from Reber to the southern corporate limits.
Second. Madam Clerk, I'm sorry, Council, do you have any questions or comments? Roll call vote, please.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
I give the motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, move to suspend the rules.
Second. Madam Clerk, please.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Do the motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, I move to consider and pass for the second and third time and adopt the ordinance.
Second. Madam Clerk, please.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Very good, thank you. Item number 10, please.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Schmidt.
Item number 10, I'd like to make a motion to receive, file, consider, and pass for the first time an ordinance amending the 2008 traffic code by amending section 553, no parking here at a corner, by adding 35A East 4th Street, west side of the 2800 block, in a southerly direction from East Donald Street.
Second.
Council, do you have any questions or comments? Madam Clerk, please.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Very good. The motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, make a motion suspending the rules.
Second.
Madam Clerk?
Mr. Lind?
Yes.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, make a motion to consider and pass for the second and third time and adopt the ordinance.
Second.
Madam Clerk, please.
Mr. Welper?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes.
Very good. That motion carries. Thank you, Council. Item number 11, please.
Mr. Mayor?
Mr. Welper?
Number 11 is a motion to receive, file, consider, and pass the second time and an ordinance amending Chapter 3 sewer regulations
Section 8-3A-6, sewer rental charge and increase sewer rates.
Second.
Council, do you have any questions on this second reading? Madam Clerk, please.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes.
Mr. Wilbur?
Yes.
Very good. That motion carries.
Mayor, make a motion to suspend the rules.
Second.
Madam Clerk, please.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
No.
Mr. Lynn?
No.
Mr. Wilbur?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Motion fails. We'll read the third time next week. Item 12, please.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Hart.
Move, receive, file, consider, and pass for the second time an ordinance amending the submission and approval of Chapter 3 Electrical Regulations of Title 9 Building Regulations of the 2007 Code of Ordinances.
Second.
Council, do you have any questions or comments regarding this item for a second reading? Madam Clerk, please.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Mr. Schmidt?
Yes.
Mr. Lynn?
Yes.
Mr. Wilbur?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Very good. The motion carries.
Mr. Mayor, I move to suspend the rules.
Second.
Madam Clerk.
Mr. Schmidt?
No.
Mr. Lynn?
No.
Mr. Wilbur?
Yes.
Mr. Hart?
Yes.
Ms. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
Motion carries. I'm sorry. The motion fails. We'll read for the final time in 2 weeks, not next week. Number 13, please.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Hart.
Move to approve change order number 3 for a net decrease of $1,390.16 with the Municipal Pipe Tool LLC of Hudson, Iowa in conjunction with Phase 1 CIP Pipelining Project Contract Number 866.
Second.
Council, do you have any questions or comments? Madam Clerk, please. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Motion carries. Thank you, Council. Ladies and gentlemen, that's the end of our regularly scheduled business tonight. It's time for oral presentations. If you have anything to the mayor or the council, please step to the microphone. Please give us your name and address and limit your comments to 3 minutes.
I had to walk up your stairs, but that's okay. Anyway, Jerry Schatzer, 1829 West 7th. The reason I'm down here, and I sure as heck didn't want to be down here, but I'm so tired of Waterloo being treated like the South was and the North came down and were the carpetbaggers. I seen you at a thing on KWWL. You were eating in Cedar Falls. Tell them what a good gourmet meal you had in Cedar Falls. Now, what the hell is the mayor doing in Cedar Falls when he lives in Waterloo? There it was on Channel 7. Another thing, I watched Mr. Welch tonight. He didn't move to Waterloo, did he? Heavens no. And then I watched KWWL had that slogan go for a while. Ron Steele is Cedar Valley's home. No, Hudson, Iowa's Ron Steele's home. And I don't know any news people from KWWL who do live in Waterloo, nor do I know any meteorology people. That's your problem with Waterloo. Number two, or number three, whatever you want to call it, you made reference to management. Well, I'll tell you what, I came one of the best managed companies you could ever work for, and everybody was managed. Because managers have a tendency, when they're left alone, God help them, they all do it. Well, I can do this and get by with this a little bit more. Nothing illegal, but just make themselves a little bit more fatter than they need to be. And that was the other thing. Now, the positive news. I'd like to thank Mr. Burke. Am I correct there, sir? Are you Burke or who?
Me.
Yeah.
Ms. Quentin Hart.
Hart, I'm sorry. For taking his stand against the coal industry not too long ago. Remember how many times on TV we seen the last year where the coal went leaked down into the lower part of the water, and some towns were without 4 and 6 weeks, and I can remember a council person who took you on about that. And so I want to congratulate you on that. The second thing I'd like to do is compliment Mr. Jim Lynn's brother. Your Jim Lynn's brother. The reason I say that, he's the only person I had stood up and said, well, you know, we're here for the people, not ourselves. I'll never forget that statement. Oh, boy, that's refreshing. And the second thing I would like to thank is our safety director. Is he here tonight? I feel bad for him. He didn't get that job, but I'm sure glad he stayed because he has one of the most difficult jobs there are. What do you got? 65% of the firemen and policemen live outside of Waterloo? That's the last statistics I heard. I don't know if that's true or not. In my low-income area, we joke about it, and they say, well, their wages are so high that they got to live outside of Waterloo because of the property tax. That's just, you know, whatever off the wall. Anyway, I got down here. I didn't think I could walk up steps because I was supposed to die twice now, and I've made it every time. And the doctor keeps saying, and other people keep saying, he's still alive. Well, anyway, thank you. Have a good night.
Thanks, Chair.
I can relax. I feel better now, and I don't have to see my shrink tomorrow.
Thanks, Chair.
Yeah.
We'll send you the bill.
Okay.
Forrest Dillavu, still Forrest Dillavu, 1725 Huntington Road. Just a couple quick items. Transparency, Mayor, you wanted transparency in the budget, and I thought we were hardly working at that, but at the last 11th hour, Quentin and you and Michelle and I don't know who else, but at least the three of you had what I would call a non-transparent meeting to set your plan in motion. I don't feel that was transparent. And on another note, Jim Chapman called me earlier this afternoon. He's sick. He wanted me to ask you folks a question, and he called it transparency. He would like some transparency in the taxpayer spending on the Sunnyside South legal matters. We would all, there's lots and lots of people ask me from day to day, how much have we spent on the Sunnyside South? And I say, we don't know. We don't get any reports. Maybe next week you could give a report as to how much we spent and where we stand, how much is left to do. The citizens of Waterloo would very much like to see that. Thank you.
Thanks, Forrest. The Sunnyside South project, I'll answer a couple of them. It's with that being in litigation, it's difficult to provide information as far as to where it stands and what's going on with that because we are still in litigation with that. As far as the cost being spent on that, we're paying attorneys. That's not our request. That's at somebody else's. We just assume not be paying those attorneys. We think it's not necessary. But anyway, and as far as you're being quite sure that me and Michelle and Quentin had a meeting to decide the budget, I'm not quite sure when that meeting was. I don't remember having a meeting.
Well, you said that Quentin was here at night, and Quentin and I visited, and he said, I've been down there working. Mm-hmm. And
did I say it was Michelle and me and Quentin had a meeting?
You said it has Quentin's handprints all over it, and he was here working on this with...
That's true.
I'm sure he wasn't working all by himself.
No, but it wasn't with me.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Good evening. My name's Pat Burke. I live at 130 Sabrina Circle. I'm down here to talk briefly about the rubble site at 63 North and Airline Highway. This was recently failed to be passed by the Board of Adjustment on the 24th of February. I understand it might come before the council. I was wondering what mechanism that it goes from failing and then coming before the council. Is that in the ordinance or?
It's just it's an automatic, isn't it, Susie? Or wait a minute, did it fail? What did it fail? Board of Adjustment or planning? What did it fail, Eric?
Eric Schrader, City Planner. There was a request for an extension to a temporary special permit, which was reviewed by the Planning and Zoning Commission and denied by the Board of Adjustment. No, there is no mechanism for a special permit denied by the Board of Adjustment to come before City Council. Their options would be to appeal to district court or resubmit.
Okay, so as far as we're concerned, it's done.
Mm-hmm.
It failed and there is no recourse, so that's good information. It will not come to the council. Pat.
Okay, then the main reason I come down tonight then is I would not be available the first 2 Mondays in April, so then that wouldn't be feasible. That would come before this body then, would it?
I don't think so, Eric. No, it would. So is the council, Eric, I'm sorry, is the council not an option for appeal for those folks? District court is the only option of appeal.
District court is their only option, or resubmitting and going back through the process again.
Okay, which certainly isn't going to happen in the next 2 weeks.
No, it would No, okay. It would not. That was a request for an extension of the existing approved. I don't have the paperwork in front of me. I think the existing approval ran them through June 30th of this year, I believe.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, well, if I may, then I typed up a couple letters that I didn't have to, but it does have some information in them that if you have time over your coffee in the morning or something, if you could read them.
Absolutely.
One's for the city attorney, and then I made copies for the...
Joe, if you could get those,
somebody
please.
Would, please. And top we'll, ones for
we'll
the city
keep
attorney,
those, Pat, and put those on file also.
And the bottom ones are for the council and the city clerk. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, sir. Is there anyone else?
Mayor,
did you have something
else? Wait, do we have someone coming to the mic, please?
Okay, Mayor, 526 Home Park Boulevard, Waterloo, Iowa. I just noticed that when Mr. Walsh got up here, you never asked him his name. I find that interesting. Anyhow, I didn't understand your answer on this Sunnyside deal. I think the only question we're asking, I understand it's in litigation. The only question we're asking is how much money have we spent year to date on this project? That's it. Not what the, where the litigation is, not anything legal. All we're asking about is dollars and cents. Is that not privy to the public?
Mr. Zellifer, could you, I would think that it is, but I'm not the attorney present here.
Yeah, we can get that stuff for you.
That's all we're asking. We just want to know how much money we've spent and where that money's coming from, not where you're at as far as the litigation and the process is concerned. We all understand that that's...
Well, some of it's hard to come up with, like if when staff works, I assume you don't expect us to put a dollar amount on that. You're probably talking about legal fees and court costs mostly.
Right.
Okay,
right.
We can get that for you.
Right.
No problem.
That's what we're asking. The second thing I need to know is that, you know, we've mentioned this several times, and you've never addressed this, and I don't expect you to address it again tonight. Why are you not putting lapel mics on your console up here? It's hard to hear these people. You can't keep telling them, move the mic up. I understand they're busy, they're thinking, and they don't move that mic up there. But for our benefit, the public, we can hear you, Mr. Clark, we can hear you good. But when it comes to listening to the rest of them, it's pretty hard sometimes because they're leaning back in their chair and we can't get the full context of what they're saying when they're saying it. So what do we have to do, or how do we go about encouraging you to complete the job here and put lapel mics on these people so we can sit out here in the audience? I got hearing aids in both ears. I have problem hearing, thanks to the U.S. government. And I need help. I can't hear you, and I know there's other people out there can't either. So we're hearing half of what you said, and sometimes we have to interpret that, and that's not good. When we started interpreting. So I just would encourage you to, whatever you're going to do, you obviously you've got money to spend it on something that will help us. And that would be a huge step in the right direction to help us, just the fact that we can hear what you're saying. Any questions from me?
Mr. Kammeyer, I did, the second time Mr. Walsh stood up, he started to speak, I did ask him for his name, and he did give it. So
no,
you must not have heard
that. Okay, whatever.
Thank you.
No big deal. Everybody knows who I'm in, anyhow.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else in the audience that would like to speak?
Mr. Mayor, motion to receive and
file. Mr. Schmidt?
Last Monday night, I wore my University of Northern Iowa tie in celebration of their winning the Missouri Valley Conference. And so tonight, I did wear my Iowa State tie in celebration of them winning the Big 12 Conference tournament. And so I've still got an Iowa tie, University of Iowa tie. I'm hoping I can wear that sometime in the next couple weeks. But I just want to congratulate Iowa State, Northern Iowa, and the University of Iowa, all three, in making it into the NCAA tournament. Wish them well.
Thank you. There will be a memo that goes out from my office tomorrow to all city employees that in celebration of all three Iowa schools making it to the NCAA tournaments, you're encouraged to wear your school colors on Thursday and Friday of this week. So we're deviating considerably from city policy as to what you can wear to work. But we do, as Mr. Schmidt just said, we want to celebrate the fact that all three Iowa schools are in the end of the NCAA. So we're going to have that. That'll come out tomorrow. Does anybody else have anything? I have a letter I want to read, but if anybody else has anything, we don't. Council, I'm going to read this. I just think it's appropriate. As you know, we just got through with the budget situation, and our public safety officers aren't always treated always with the most reverence that I think they should. And this is actually a, it doesn't have to be dire consequences for us to give kudos to. This is from a Waterloo Police Sergeant that's written to Director Trelka regarding the Waterloo Fire Department. It says, "Dear Chief, we were sent to a residential fire at 937 Dawson early Saturday morning." That's this past Saturday. "When police officers arrived at the front of the house, it was fully engulfed. We were told there were two people still inside. Officer Schaff attempted to go through the back door, but the smoke was too thick. When fire rescue got there, they took care of business. Multiple guys went into the house through the back and attempted to get a very large female out. It took them a long time to get her out, but the effort they gave was unbelievable. They really put their lives on the line to save this woman. Watching them fight the fire at the front of the house that was quickly spreading to the rest of the house while simultaneously trying to get the lady out in the back was very impressive. Once they got the woman out, you could see how drained many of them were. Until you actually see those guys in action, you have no idea how important they are to the city. All of us from the PD who witnessed this wanted to make sure you were aware of their heroic actions." Those are the kind of firemen we have in our city, ladies and gentlemen, and we should celebrate that every single day. Thank you.
Motion to receive and file oral comments and adjourn.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We're adjourned. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.